Hello and welcome to WION's Global Leadership Series. It's a show where we interview heads of state to comment on current affairs, to understand their perspective and to make sense of our world today. Our guest today is the Prime Minister of Slovenia, Mr. Janez Janša, joining us from the capital, Ljubljana. Prime Minister Janša, welcome to WION.
Thank you.
Slovenia will take over the EU presidency next month. And this is a crucial period for the region because most of Europe will be thinking about post-pandemic priorities. How do you plan to shape the EU's policies and priorities in the next 6 months? And what are your hopes for the presidency?
Yes, first of all, no matter who is the presidency of the Council of the European Union, the problems coming from the post-COVID situation are obvious, and everybody will deal with them. So the key words for this post-COVID period are recovery and resilience. And because the European Union adopted quite ambitious economic plan for recovery last year with our own sources, also European sources, first time in our history also to be part of it, there is enough resources, good plans now, which are under the approval, on the procedure of the approval of the European Commission. And this will be our priority. And also building the capacities we missed last year at the beginning of the pandemic is also very important priority. And of course, we are in the middle of the discussion regarding future of Europe. The conference on the future of Europe has started a few weeks ago, and the biggest part of the discussion is coming into our presidency. So many tasks, and we all hope that we will be able to manage them through the physical meetings, not via audio-video conferences.
Right. The European Parliament has also backed a patent waiver for Wuhan virus vaccines, and more than 100 countries have supported this resolution at the World Trade Organization. But the European Union is blocking it. What's your stand on this?
Well, it's majority belief in the European Union that The most important thing regarding helping the others, helping others, is to provide the vaccines. Because speaking about the patents, knowledge, and so on, this is important, but it doesn't help immediately. So, the European Union concentrated on the COVAX network to contribute as much vaccines as possible to other parts of the world. And these contributions from different EU member countries are increasing every day, Now we reach the situation when we have more vaccines in many countries than there is the interest for the vaccination. So the European contribution to COVAX will be much higher during next month than it was planned. And this is the most important. And all other debates, how to share this knowledge, how to be better prepared for possible future pandemics, can take a little while. So, but the most important thing, to produce as many vaccines as possible, to be prepared for new variants, to have flexible science with the answers on the new variants, and to make as high number as possible of the world population to be vaccinated till the end of this year.
So do you support a patent waiver or do you not?
Well, I think that this is not the solution. My personal belief is we are of different opinion inside of the European Union. My personal belief is that this will kill the competition, which is also needed among the producers, and at the end we will all suffer.
Right. Do you feel that the European Union's actions during the pandemic, especially on this issue of vaccine distribution, are at some level counterproductive, that they're prolonging the pandemic by promoting inequity?
I think it's a miracle. We needed less than 1 year to produce not only one, but many effective vaccines against COVID. We know from the history that during the last decades, we needed 10 years for some vaccines. So this was a miracle. Speaking from the point of the European Union, I think it was a good decision to make common purchases, to make common agreements with some pharmaceutical companies, despite some of those agreements were not fulfilled from those companies. But mostly, this common approach was successful, especially looking from the point of the smaller EU member states. It would be maybe better for France and Germany, Italy to deal with this issue separately. But at the end, I think the decision to go together into this battle was better for Europe and for the other parts of the world, because together we can also contribute. We can also contribute much more doses, because we know what's the situation in specific countries, we know what's the situation on the European level, and the European Commission can coordinate also the help for others much more efficiently than if we are separately in this battle.
Right, let's talk about your relationship with the EU. After Brexit, there were calls within Hungary and Poland to quit the union. How does Slovenia see these growing differences within the bloc? And your critics, in fact, call you a Eurosceptic. Do you agree with this assessment?
Look, I'm not Eurosceptic. I have been fighting for Europe and European values for whole 30 years. Slovenia is celebrating 30 years of our independence. This year, these days, we are in celebration mood. And 30 years ago, Europe was our, you know, far dream. It came through much, much faster. Also, the quality of life in Slovenia has improved significantly during this period. And we are in front of our second leadership of the Europe, or the Council of the European Union. I was prime minister when we did our first job. It was valued very much at that time. We were first new member country, leading the European Council at that time, before the Lisbon Treaty came on power, and also the Council of the European Union. But, and frankly speaking, you mentioned Poland and Hungary. The public support in Poland and Hungary for European Union is much higher than, for instance, in Netherlands or France. And when we negotiated closer union 15 years ago, so-called constitution on Europe, the referendums to approve this constitution failed in France and Netherlands, not in Slovenia, Poland and Hungary. So it is one picture mostly shown in mass media, and there is mood among the population, and this is what counts at the end.
Okay, your government has also repeatedly cut off funding to Slovenia's public broadcasting service, the STA, and it has become a rallying point for your opponents, and many believe the STA is being punished for their journalism. How do you respond to your critics?
We are speaking about the political issue and the political game going on in Slovenia. I don't know how this goes in India, but in Slovenia, when the government pays some money, we need a contract, we need a job to be done, and we need a bill. And we are settling these issues now. Now we have one ruling from the European Commission about the public financing, and the government finally settled this issue last week when we passed the act on the financing. And from our side, everything is settled, but you know, some people in this agency were politically appointed and they are playing political games. This is why it is the loudness of this is so big. It came to India, I see. But this is not our major problem.
Right. In the month of March, in fact, the European Union, European Commissioner criticized your comments about journalists. And I'm quoting from what they said. The EU does not accept and condemns the insulting remarks towards journalists. And then recently in a tweet, you said that the Council of Europe's Commissioner for Human Rights is part of the quote-unquote fake news network. Where is this going, Prime Minister Janša?
First, it's not the Commissioner of the European Commission. In Europe, we have European Union, and we have Council of Europe, where also Russia is and Turkey are the members. And this lady is coming from this part of the Europe, not EU member country and EU membership. It's two totally different organizations. And speaking about the free speech and media freedom. Look, 33 years ago, I was a young journalist writing critical articles regarding communist regime. I was arrested, sentenced in prison 2 times. So I know what's the freedom of speech. I know what's the freedom of media. And don't believe everything you see written in European newspapers. There are different newspapers with different opinions. If somebody wants to check the situation, he or she is very warmly welcome to come to Slovenia and to check it, to read our newspapers, watch our televisions. Whoever is coming, he is able to see that 95% of the news are criticizing the government. So freedom of media is total in Slovenia.
I understand, and I appreciate your taking all the questions. The European Union also instituted a new chief prosecutor's office to investigate corruption cases in the bloc. But Slovenia is being accused of not cooperating. In fact, the chief prosecutor herself accused your government of, and I'm quoting again, of undermining the trust in the effective management of EU funds. Why has Slovenia not appointed delegates to the new office?
Well, actually, the story is a little more complex. This is not the EU institution. It's so-called enhanced cooperation. So many European countries are not participating in this network. For instance, Sweden is not participating, Poland is not participating, Ireland is not participating, Denmark is not participating, and some other countries. So it's our free will to join the European Prosecution Office. We decided to join, and we will do it when we will fulfill our national procedure. It was a problem with this procedure, according to our law. Because we had some problems in the past, we need more candidates for one post. In this case, only one candidate for one post has been proposed from the Prosecutor's Council, and this is why the procedure is repeating. This is the only problem.
Now, this is a question I've been wanting to ask you. Your critics called you Marshal Tito. That's what they called you, a reference to the former dictator of Yugoslavia. Some others compare you to Donald Trump. How do you describe yourself, Prime Minister?
I don't have so high ambitions to describe myself. But speaking of Twitter, you know, I think that when we are speaking about the freedom of expression and media freedom, the freedom of expression of the free individual is first, and the freedom of media is second. So, and Twitter is helping to the individuals to express freely on the matters. And sometimes this is not very welcome from the journalists or from the medias who had monopoly on the expression in the past. Technology is bringing changes, and the internet is the biggest equalizer after the education in the modern world.
You've also just survived an impeachment, and there are protests political protests in Slovenia. What would you say to those 20,000 odd people who gathered in your capital city 3 weeks ago to demand that your government should step down and pave the way for fresh elections?
How many thousands, you said?
According to the report I read, 20,000.
Yeah, well, there are not 20,000, but since the pandemic started in Slovenia, we had protests every Friday. Every Friday, people are protesting against different things, against vaccination, against the masks, against the measures we were pushed to introduce to tame the pandemic. So, and Slovenia is a free country. During the pandemic also, which was not very helpful, you know, to stop the pandemic, people has been protesting every Friday. So if you come to Slovenia on Friday, you have to avoid the city center because your movement will be limited, but your freedom will not be limited.
I'll keep that in mind. There's a major realignment also happening in Europe with member states demanding more engagement in the Indo-Pacific. What, according to you, should be the EU strategy in this new power struggle, a new power equation?
I personally would like to speak about the competition, not the power struggle. But in reality, unfortunately, we came to this situation. It's a power struggle. And Indo-Pacific, your country especially, I think is a key point in this clash of values, which is becoming global on many levels, but we can see, not totally clear, but still visible division between the free countries with parliamentary democracy, with rule of law, and the countries with authoritarian regimes. And I think that these first countries, so free countries, can prevail in this clash only if you win in Indo-Pacific region with prevailing with your way of life. So with the democracy, rule of law, respect for different opinions, and also not interfering into historical disagreements from the centuries ago. So we have to focus on future, but we have not to forget the values.
Indeed, and we recently saw a strong statement from the G7 about China. It demanded transparency from Beijing on the pandemic. It also called out the Communist Party for human rights violations and Xinjiang and Hong Kong. And some European leaders signed on the statement. But do you believe that Europe as a whole and the European Union has done enough to contain the growing threat from China?
Frankly speaking, no. Frankly speaking, no. As many times during the history from the last, especially two centuries, we are seeing understatement of the situation. We are seeing behavior where the values are second and economic interests are first. I think that we have to change these priorities. Values first and economic interests, which are important, of course, second. We can disagree. We can have different values. We can still make trade. It is how life has been gone through the history. But there are some limits. There are some limits, and I welcome the conclusions from the G7 and also the communique from the recent NATO summit we hold in Brussels, because maybe first time the freedom-loving countries are taking China seriously, are starting to take China seriously.
So then what
in all its dimensions.
Sure. What then do you make of statements like the one that came from French President Emmanuel Macron, who said that we don't share a border with China, so for us China is not a threat?
The world is global today, and China is very present in Europe. It's even strongly present in our neighborhood, in Africa, in the Mediterranean basin. We don't have border with China, but you know, what are the borders now? So it's different if you if China is your bordering country and you have some problems, as you well know this, but China is a global power. It's much important challenger than Russia or some other countries, and I think that European Union, United States, India, Japan, Australia, and other countries have to cooperate some approaches toward China together. And I think that if we are strong, if we are determined, if we are clear about our values, we can deal with China peacefully. We can make trade, they have to know where are the limits.
The European Union has been accused of basically sitting on the fence. They want to contain China, but they also want to do business with China. As you take over the EU presidency, will this be one of your top agenda points to ensure that there is clarity of policy vis-a-vis Beijing?
Look, I'm not against doing business with China, but I'm against crossing the lines. One of the lines is we are trying to determine now, when in Europe we are speaking about the so-called strategic autonomy. We saw last year that almost everything we needed to tame the pandemic in the first wave was produced in China, not in Europe, small amounts in India and some other parts of the world. So now Europe is building capacities to be not to be dependent to other parts of the world when they are speaking about personal protective equipment, critical medicine equipment, vaccines, everything what you need when the crisis is coming. We are also discussing, and I hope we will be successful, this is also one of our priorities during next half of the year, cybersecurity. We're also discussing how to be more careful with the technology, which is very needed because the cyber threats are second to nuclear. We have to be aware for the developed countries, for the modern civilization, cyber attacks can cause more damage than any kind of classical weapons. It's a threat second to nuclear, and we have to deal with it like that. So, you're right, the discussion has started. We are not yet there, but I'm optimistic. So within a few years, the situation will change and the lines will be very, very clear. And I think that after that, the real negotiations also with China are possible. And this is crucial to preserve the world peace.
Do you believe the U.S. under the current leadership is as they say, America is back and is in a position to lead a global effort to make sure that we have a rules-based order?
Well, I think that America is the most important among this democratic bloc of the countries, but it's the situation we face is not the same as it was during the Cold War. At that time, United States were more or less strong enough to deal with this nuclear threat and other threats coming from this Cold Division. currently it's not the same. It's not the same if you look at the figures, the manpower, the technology and so on. I think that the North America, European Union or Europe and India, Japan, Australia, some other countries together can make a real difference. Not the United States alone, but without United States, whole bloc is not sufficient.
What role do you see for India in this changing world order?
A growing role, a crucial role. I said at the beginning that even North Atlantic Alliance, so North America and Europe together, are not enough. So at least India has to join this club, and I hope this will happen. We don't need something we had during the Cold War or the beginning of Cold War, new NATO, including India and so on. No, we need a flexible alliance where India is included. And I think that negotiations going on between European Union and India on free trade agreement and other agreements which are on the table are crucial on this path. So we are in favor of these negotiations. I think it's not only business as usual, it's not only about the economic interests, it's about strategic interests of Europe and India together.
Right. And Slovenia, in fact, was one of the European countries that came to India's help during the second wave of this pandemic. How do you see this relationship going forward?
I'm glad we were able to help a little, but otherwise I think that the European response was not as fast as should be. It's one excuse. We were still at that time in the middle of the spring wave of the pandemic, dealing with our problems. Some of our neighbors had difficult situation, in Slovenia included, at the beginning of this year. But we had very good discussion with your Prime Minister during the Porto summit, and I think that is after this summit some things are very clear now. And Slovenia wants to be part of this cooperation. We are aware of the importance of India currently and even more for the future. So consider Slovenia a big friend of the good relations between India and European Union.
That's very good to hear. Slovenia is also slowly reopening its borders to tourists, and you've just told me I can come there in 2 weeks from now. You've also adopted different levels of restrictions for tourists based on which country they're coming from. How does this tie in with the EU's proposed digital COVID certificate system? And would you push for extending these certificates to non-EU nations like the United States?
Actually, I'm very glad, and this was a small miracle we agreed so fast, that European Union is introduced this EU pass or digital green certificate, which was called before. Making common approach inside of the European Union, which is also the first step to make a common approach toward third countries. And I hope that the European Union, on behalf of all member states, we'll negotiate the same approach with as many third countries as possible during next weeks and months. Not every single EU member country, to negotiate with everybody outside, but to join forces. And as I said before, this EU pass is a good basis, is a first step, which is making possible this common approach. So I believe that if you are coming to Slovenia in August or September, you will be to enter the country and whole European Union according to very simple procedure. We propose that even before we reach this agreement, we confirm any kind of certificate from the third countries where similar standards are used for fighting pandemic. So if you are vaccinated and or if you are tested and you have some paper proof or some digital proof that this is true, you're welcome.
Right. I know this pandemic has been a test of leaders and leadership the world over, and different countries have done according to their capacity. What would you say about India's role globally in fighting the pandemic, from sending medicines to vaccines?
I think that when we started with the vaccination and there was huge interest and very little supply, a small number of doses coming from this, common purchasing, European purchasing. We have been all watching toward India because we see that India is very big producer, not only of specific vaccines, but also of the ingredients. And it was discussion among us, how to make this cooperation faster, closer, and so on. Then, unfortunately, India was hit by this Delta variant and very severe situation. And then the tide turned, so you needed help. But I think that when we discussed how to help India, we all remember that India at the beginning was on the supply part of the chain, a country which helped a lot to neighbors and to all others, and which was able also to organize its science, its pharmaceutics companies and production capacities to produce as many vaccines as possible in as short time as possible.
Right. This is a question I should have started with, but I'll end with it. Post 18 months of the pandemic, Prime Minister Janša, how are you doing and how are the people of Slovenia doing?
Currently, they are relaxing. We are all relaxing. Coincidentally, as I said before, we are celebrating 30 years of our independence, our 30th birthday. So the mood is quite good because of this. We are taking rotating presidency of the Council of the European Union, and we are also exiting the epidemic. So the numbers are going down every day. Yesterday, it was the first day after October last year when we had no one single death case from COVID, and this was something to celebrate. The supply of the vaccines is increasing. People are thinking about vacations. The summer is coming, so the mood is okay. We are also opening the touristic facilities. People, according to the decision of the government from yesterday, we are giving to everybody a touristic voucher for 100 euros for the touristic and cultural events to be paid. So the mood is 100% better than it was during New Year.
That sounds very good. Thank you very much, and happy birthday to your country. And thank you for joining us and for taking all the questions that came your way.
Thank you very much.